when I started doing music and I was getting a little bit of money here, a little bit, my mother would say to me, when are you going to get a real job? And after a while, she was like, you have a real job, don't you? You know, and I was grateful for all those times every day where she would make me practice. You know, that consistent practice, which I just hated to do, but I knew it was important. So I think, you know, certainly in life, when we got that desire, that dream to do something, we're going to say, okay, how are we going to do that? So first of all, KJ, I want to ask you, go back to maybe when you did make that decision, or musician first, what was the transition? What inspired you? What made, you know, what got you into what you do?
Okay, I think I'll just react to all the P's that you mentioned. Every one of them that you mentioned was triggering a memory in my head and going, taking me to a place where all those P's started in my life, all of them. And I think the first one is the purpose one. I think that's what you're asking. And surprisingly for me, the call came very late. I was a musician, I played guitar, I had a band right from school, carried forward that to college. You do the usual stuff, you play in competitions, you play with a bunch of people who like similar kind of music. So you don't even actually explore beyond the comfort zone that you have in musically as well. You know, you're all comfortable in rock or jazz or whatever, and you kind of just progress almost blindly into that. You really don't, you're not thinking, but you're just reacting. So you did that circuit and you do session work as a musician, people start calling you saying, well, you play guitar, so can you come and play on my advertisement jingle, or can you come and play, do work for me for some background score, a little bit. I'm from Delhi, so mostly, anybody from Delhi?
We forgive you for that, that's okay.
So, at that time we only had what we call Doordarshan. We didn't have any of the channels, we had nothing, we had no radio, we had only government controlled media. So everything was for them, whatever you did. Surprisingly, one show we did as a band, and there was tremendous amount of feedback. And that got me really riled up and saying, I mean, I had a huge spat with the sound engineer at that point saying, why were we getting this feedback? And why couldn't you sort this out? Why was the sound such a mess? We couldn't perform. So purely all the outbursts of a typical musician on stage, not getting things right. And he actually had no answers for me, which I could be satisfied with. And I just thought, why shouldn't I look into it and make sure that we sort that out ourselves? And first understand, what is this feedback? Why does this happen? Why is this bass frequency or a particular tom ring coming into my guitar tone and bothering me? Why is this monitor not sounding right? So I then went to another sound engineer friend of mine who used to do live sound and said, can you teach me? And he said, yeah, but I don't have much time, I'm busy doing a lot of shows. So I said, okay, I'll come with you as your roadie and I will help you with your show so we get to spend more time. And in return, you teach me what you know.
See, I think that's a very important thing. You found someone where you could learn from, yeah. Even if you just had to tag along, but you could actually, you were doing something.
Yeah.
And I think that's, just to go briefly to Muncie, if you can just give me the mic for a sec. So just as we stay in this zone of starting out, how was it for you when you started out, when you made that decision? Was there being a musician involved or?
No, actually, in my whole family, I'm from a very small town, Indore. So in my whole family, no one is from music industry and no one is from industry. They don't know anything about this industry. And for a fact, they don't know what I'm doing actually. They just say ki she's recording, she's mixing, but they don't know actually what my job is. So I know for a fact that I don't want to do engineering, because in my family all are engineers or doctors. So I don't want to do engineering kind of thing. So there is one college in Indore which provide educational media, everything in media. So in one of the semester I have this subject called sound engineering. Gradually doing projects, I got interest in that. So after completing my graduation, I just packed my bags and told my parents that I'm going to Mumbai
That's like the dream.
Because they are not understanding ki, they are saying ki your all sisters and brothers got jobs, so they are going to Mumbai. So why are you going to Mumbai? You don't have any job. So I said, can just packing my bags.
And you're a young lady as well. So I'm sure that was also, you know, my goodness me.
But they said, ki, okay, you go. I said, ki, in 1 month, if I don't find anything, I'll come back. So I got training in one of the Ajivasan studio in Santa Cruz. So they said, ki, okay, you do. So I said, ki, I'm not getting paid. So I want to do for 1 year. So they supported me, they are sending money and all that. But after that, I got
Your family sent you money?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
And you were meant to go to Bombay and send money back to them. How messed up is that?
Now I'm doing it.
Now you're doing that. And we'll come to that in a minute.
Because I told them, if you want me to do post-graduation, you just think I'm doing PG for 2 years in here. You just send me money. I want to do that job.
Very smart.
They said, okay. But in between, they are telling me, you are not doing anything. Your brothers are doing something. They are earning. So I just said, okay, I'm enjoying this. I'm not looking for any holidays. And they are looking for that. So I'm enjoying my job. So they said, okay. After that 1 year in Ajivasan, I got one job, but I'm not happy with that job because it's more of programming or musician thing than engineering thing. So then I called Shantanu sir. So he said, ki, come for 3 months internship. If I am happy with your work, then I'll like expand your internship over there.
Okay, so we'll come back to that in a minute. Because so you worked at Ajivasan 2 years for nothing?
No.
No money?
No money.
You made tea? Good tea?
Not exactly I made tea or anything, but I used to clean, but I used to take care of that studio equipment.
Well, the thing is here, you've actually got T-Boy, you've got everything, and the T-Boy, yeah. Stay a T-Boy all his life. It's like in a studio in the West, you start as T-Boy, and then suddenly you're George Martin, you know, overnight. You know, it's amazing. So I think here, yeah, I guess that you don't become a T-boy and then you become chief engineer. But I think that, okay, so you went in, you were actually doing hands-on, but you were kind of junior assistant sort of thing.
Not exactly. I'm not doing anything. I'm just, because everything is new for me. I've never seen that console. I've never seen Pro Tools and everything. So I'm learning from
Spark. So you're watching and just...
Yeah,
okay,
I'm watching.
Okay,
and
so that was smart. Yeah. So what's interesting is that you decided to do that without pay because it was important to as a learning curve.
Yeah, because that time I don't know, so it's not it's of no use to do job because I don't know anything. So first I have to learn there and practical, not like books and all.
Yeah, I'm, you're hands on. I mean, there's nothing better than being in the studio.
Yeah. I used to do theaters in Indore. Whenever any theater or any group of the play coming from Mumbai, I used to go and watch there. So one day, without any planning, me and my mom went there. There was play of Prashant Dambe, very fine actor of Marathi industry. So after finishing play, I used to go and talk to their technical team. So I went there and I was asking, okay, I want to do this. So you know anyone in Mumbai, I'm planning to there. So that technical guy said me, ki, I don't know anything. You just talk to Prashant Dambe, he'll help you. So I was like, no, he's actor. How can he talk to me? He said, ki, you go. So he was, Prashant Dambe was having pictures with his fans and all. So I just said, ki, I'm Manskare, I want to do engineering. So he stopped taking photos with them. He said, ki, you want to be a sound engineer? Yeah, but I don't have any contacts. He said, ki, you come to Mumbai after your graduation, here's my number, you call me, we'll see. So after going to Mumbai, I just randomly called because I don't have anything to do. I called him, he said, ki, I want to be. He just gave me Ajivasan's number. Actually, because of him, I'm in Yashraj. He just called Shantanu sir randomly because I was very frustrated with my job. I was crying and all because I have nothing to do. So he said, ki, okay, where you want to go? I just randomly say Yashraj Studio. He said, which engineer?
That was a good random choice, definitely. My goodness.
Because he was asking which studio you want to go.
Did you know any other ones? That was the only one you knew about?
Is there any other studio?
Empire Studios and all, but Yashraj Studios is big name. So I just said,
yeah, went for the top. Why not? Yeah, you know, forget the rest. I'm going right to the top.
Yeah, he was asking which studio you want to go. I think Yashraj want to go.
But you see, okay, so we go to number four on my list of P's, people. People going in your direction. So you found someone who could help you.
Yeah.
And but you had to make that, you know, talk to them first before they could talk to someone else.
Yeah.
And so you didn't sit back and rest on your laurels. So KJ, come back. We'll come back to you. Mm-hmm. You can grab the mic. Thank you for that. Really insightful. I mean, it's very. You said you went to see theatre a lot, so you had an interest in that side of things.
Yeah.
But it's interesting that you came from that angle. But that's a great story, actually. Really, really. I think it gets better when it gets to the Yashraj bit. We'll come back into that in a little bit. We just keep a little bit of excitement going. So you were getting frustrated with engineers, and you thought, well, I could probably do a better job. So let me sort of try and work out how to.
Yeah, not so much as a better job, but just try and understand. And I think after so many years of being doing this, I just realized that it's like what Steve Jobs said, connecting the dots. They do come back, and you connect them at some point. What you do early on somehow gets related. So I was thinking that if I understand the sound part of this whole thing, it'll just help me better as a musician. So I actually went at it from that point of view, not realizing ultimately that I would actually switch to the other side of the class. But it so happened that the engineering side of it caught my fancy so much that I actually did that I went abroad to do a course, and I said, I want to study it more. And in India at that point of time, I'm talking about the mid-80s, FTI was the only institute which was there, and they had this combined course with audio and film and everything, and I just wanted to do audio. So that was my decision at that point. Then that's when I decided I want to do it seriously, and I decided to pursue and do a proper, you know, education, get myself educated in that.
So I think that sound engineers that are, and I know that you're not a musician per se, but I think that is an added bonus if you're a musician. How did you put the gig in down? Did that stop? Was it a complete transition from performing to being, as you say, behind the other side of the glass?
Slowly. I mean, what happens is also college bands last only as long as you're in college, unless you're really, really serious about it. There's one band here called Spart in the Box, which we are producing right now. They were a college band who were in the same college, most of them. So there was this question mark after college, what are they going to hang around and still continue doing things seriously as a profession or not? And I think every musician who is in a band especially, they all go through this process in the third year of their college life. What now?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it happened with me as well. Luckily, I had the engineering side to look into. I mean, I thought I can make this as a career.
So you had a backup plan, I guess.
I didn't have a backup plan. It just became the plan.
I didn't have one. Right.
Like what you said about planning, I just wanted to point that out. I didn't really have a plan at that point of time. But the day I realized that this is what I really wanted to do,
then you got.
That's when
time.
I got very secure about I need to do this. I need to know more about this, and that's when I went going about getting.
Yeah, because I think it's not always that you suddenly wake up and go, I know what I'm going to do. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it just happens. You know, it just becomes part of, and then, as you say, then you kind of work out how you're going to do that.
Yeah, like in Mansi's case, you know, she's so right in that, you know, you have this desire to want to do something. And I think that propels you in a direction, in a particular way, to meet the right people. Again, back to P, the people, again, purpose, people. And it's up to you to take that initiative. You meet somebody, you say, hey, I want your help.
Mm.
You don't know who they are, you don't know how they can connect you with whoever, whatsoever it might be. But you take that initiative first and say, I want your help.
And it is a risk but you have to understand that person you're asking for help probably asked someone else for help, who asked someone else for help, and hopefully they'll remember that in the back of their mind, I remember when I was asking for help, and they will be sensitive and will understand that. And I think that if they're not, then move on to the next person. But you've got to say, I'm not going to be bashful, I'm not going to be reserved, I'm going to step forward and ask someone for help.
Oh yeah, you need to take the first step. If you don't do it, then how will they know?
Yeah, it's rarely will ever just someone will knock on your door and say, hey, going to give you a movie, or you want to be a sound engineer? You know, that'd be nice. But the reality is, it is a lot of hard work. So you've both worked on some amazing projects. KJ, as you've got the mic in your hand at the moment, Could you tell me what has been the highlight for you so far in your career?
Every day is a highlight.
That's wonderful. That's wonderful. But is this something that, I mean, I know what you mean. For me, if I'm sitting there recording the orchestra and I'm going, oh man, this is amazing.
This is it. I'm exactly. This is it.
Yeah. So that is fantastic. I mean,
it is. I think when you enjoy what you are doing, first and foremost, I think you do lose a sense of time. You lose a sense of everyday existence as to when you have to eat, when you have to take a break. It actually just snowballs into just trying to finish or trying to do what you're doing because you're enjoying this so much. So I don't look at it as work in that sense, and I tell everybody I'm on a perpetual holiday. You know, I mean, I'm here for a whole long holiday break.
Yeah, I mean, I was working with a director of photography last week in London, and he said he is the happiest when he's on set working. That is actually his life.
Yeah.
And when he's not, that's like as if he had some horrible job.
Yeah, that thought does cross my mind. So like you said, highlight. I think the one biggest jump for me was moving from Delhi to Bombay, and I think that's where the film business came into play. In Delhi, there is no film industry. We only do television and radio. So when this offer came to actually move and try and do something in film, I actually resisted it for 2 years.
Why was that? Was that not the sort of thing that I would like to do?
No, it's not really that. I think, again, back to the obstacle thing came in that at first, it was just a gut reaction to, I have a well-established running, it's a comfort zone. Mm-hmm. I had a studio in Delhi, I had my own clientele in Delhi, I was doing okay. I was producing new bands, Parikrama, Euphoria, everybody was coming around that time. Mm-hmm. So it was great fun working with those guys. And then this offer came to do a film in Bombay, and I said, I don't know if I really want to move or do something in Bombay. I didn't like the city at that point. And I'd come twice and I didn't like it at all. And I said, I'm comfortable in Delhi, friend, family, support structure, everything is there. So I did back and forth for about 2 years.
Okay, that must have been quite tricky.
That was tricky because, I mean, to just give you a quick example, like you come in the morning flight and you go to the studio because you get a call one day before that Lataji is going to dub the song the next day. So you take the flight, you come to the studio and your studio opens at 10, you sit there and we're talking about 2-inch machine. So you set it up, align it, get everything prepped up, and 11 o'clock the call comes saying, Didi is not feeling well. So everybody else in Bombay goes back to their job or whatever they're doing. What do you do? You're stranded in Bombay.
Yeah.
Do I wait? Is she going to give me time or should I go back? So that became like a very frustrating experience to kind of figure out. And at that point I decided I need to take a call on this, you know, whether I shift or don't shift.
So you did the shift. So
then I did the shift, yes.
So it's interesting because you came to the city from Indore, you came from Delhi. So I love this idea that I think the big city, certainly, I mean, I come from a countryside and I went to London to study music, and you know, it's that dream of that something you can do in that place that doesn't exist in your hometown. And you're right, you can get very comfortable in a situation, and sometimes...
For me, it was never a dream to go to Bombay, actually. You know, earlier on, I didn't have this dream or aspiration to be in Bombay, surprisingly. Everybody asked me that, so you always wanted to come to Bombay? I said, no, I didn't. I mean, my only connection with Bombay was Stardust. I mean, at once in a while, I would look at some pictures and I'd say, oh, so-and-so is that actor, so okay, great, I mean, big deal. But that's about it. And the only connect, if at all, was the music to some extent, because I actually didn't grow up on too much of Bollywood music as well. R.D. Burman to an extent, his father S.D. Burman to an extent, but that's about it.
So you mentioned R.D. Burman and S.D. Burman.
Yeah.
You kept that really quiet. Can we just, I mean, you're talking about, you know...
The guys, I know, I mean...
Massively inspirational of another era, but that set the scene. I mean, S.D. Burman, you know, and then obviously, you know...
Yeah, for a school-going kid or a college-going kid, their audience music was the one which caught your fancy, and not Salil Chaudhary or Hemant Kumar, because they were more the classist, so to speak, of the music-making in the Bollywood scene.
But, you know, Adi Bama was using Moog synths,
Latin, mixing up things in a really amazing way. So that caught your fancy, and you said, okay, this guy's doing something interesting. Right? But it was not still motivation enough for me to say, I'll leave everything and go to Bombay. It was not like that, or a dream for anybody in the rest of the USA to want to go to LA.
Yeah.
I didn't have that dream. It just came to me and I struggled with it, till I took a call to say, okay, we're done with it. I mean, let's move.
But I like that's the reality of life. That it's not always so straightforward.
Yeah,
I think that's a great example. That
and I had a family. I mean, I had two kids. I had one wife, two kids. And I
wasn't two wives and one kid. Just going to get that straight, you know.
Yeah.
Freudian slip there.
Yeah, it's good to confess that on stage once in a while. You know, one wife, two kids. So I had to move bag and baggage. It was not just me.
Yeah, so you had a responsibility.
I
mean, certainly when you're younger and you haven't got that, then you can be a bit more sort of, you know, you can do rash things a little bit. And I think that I'd like to just, I mean, that's amazing, you know, working with Adi Berman. Mansi, just, I know that when I was working at Yash Raj, and then you came in and you were, what were you referred to as? You were intern, you were an intern for 3 months.
Yeah.
Then what happened? Because you were there a lot longer than that.
She's still there.
She's still there, but so you joined in when? 2011?
I think 2011, 2012.
Now, something happened in May last year. I was in the studio and you had a little envelope in your hand.
Yeah.
And what was it?
Yeah, that was my job letter.
It was your first wage, wasn't it? It was your, I think you had your first payment.
Yeah, it was.
So how long did you work without getting paid?
1.5 years.
See, that's the dedication. You know, 1.5 years working and doing everything really, you know, just setting up the desk and the Pro Tools.
Yeah.
And one thing that I've said, we were talking with Lauren earlier about the engineers in Macedonia who are great. But I mean, the engineers, the experience I've had here from Western Outdoor with Daman Zudin and Avinash Oak and people like that to working at Empire when Chantanu was there and with, I forget the other guys that came after that. Everyone, yeah, Chinmay. And then with Shantanu Mukherjee. I mean, all the engineers I've worked with, they've just been incredible. You know, you're doing the strings, you go, can you just comp that? I've done it, sir. You know, so it's amazing. It's that sort of forward thinking where it's like, you don't have to worry about it, it's done. And that is a really important thing. The importance of the engineer is cannot be, you know, emphasized enough. So then you've become now, what's your role? What are you officially called there?
Assistant engineer.
That's brilliant. That's great. And you get paid now?
Yeah, I get paid now.
And you still do all the work and everyone else just relaxes. But
yeah.
So what have been the highlights? Because you've worked on, you know, pretty much all the big movies that are coming through there now.
Yeah.
So what has been, has there been a session where, and you can say it's my session if you want, but no, I'm just kidding. But when you've worked on a session and you've sat there and go, you know, that, coming from indoor with my little stick and a bag, walking, you know, hitchhiking all the way, I'll get on the train.
You've seen too many Rajkumar movies.
I have, haven't I? That's all. Yeah, exactly. But has there been a moment where you go, no, this is what I, you know, I had in my mind, or this, has there been anything like that that you've, or have you been too busy just getting the right settings and things? And
there are many sessions which I actually enjoyed. When I was in Yash Raj or when I'm in Yash Raj, I never thought ki I will be here because I have never dreamed.
But you said you wanted to be.
I wanted to be engineer, but I never thought ki I will be in Yash Raj or I will be in Ajivasan because they are the top places which everyone wants to be. So every session in Yash Raj is like dream for me. But one session where I record, where we recorded German orchestra, with Rahman sir, that was yeah.
The Babelsberg, yeah, yeah,
yeah. That was dream session there.
But I think what you're saying is that you never imagined, but you did say, even though it was just the one studio you thought of, yes, went to that actor, I want to go to Yash Raj. And so you've got to visualize it, you know, when you have that vision, then you've got something to focus on. And I think that was, you know, even if it was slightly subconscious that you weren't really aware of the importance of what you were saying.
Yeah.
And now you're sitting there, you know, 2-3 years later, that you're actually working there and you're enjoying every moment of it. And I think that is, you know, incredible.
I think that's going back to what you just said about planning and having it in your head. I mean, imagine if she had asked for a Studio X in Dhobi Talao. That's where she would be.
Yeah.
You know?
If so someone is asking for something, so I ask better than Yash
Raj. Ask for the best. I mean, this is where I want to be. I mean, exactly. What she said was bang on. Like, you know, what you want to be, aspire to be where you want to be. That's what you ask for.
Because when Shantanu sir offered me 3 months internship, that time I thought ki I want to work here, nothing, nowhere else. Because the working environment and the support from Shantanu sir and Abhishek sir, actually. Because for a girl to survive in this industry, where there are many engineers and such support is very, I'm very lucky to work with Abhishek sir and Shantanu sir, who actually taught me taking pen and pencil. Why this? Because I have not done any course, actually, diploma course or in sound engineering. So Abhishek sir is actually teaching me ki why this we are doing this, why feedback is coming, why this channel, why this pre.
This is the best way. You know, you can't learn that in college.
Hi, my name is Vinju Jacob Thomas.
Sorry, your name is?
Vinju Jacob Thomas.
Vinju Jacob Thomas.
Yeah, so my question is basically when you made the transition from being a musician to a sound engineer. So when I came over here and I did some courses from London as well, it was sound engineering, mixing, production, composition, everything. So when I came over here, I started out meeting like sound designers, and because those were the only people I knew. So, and I was saying like, is it okay to start off as like a sound engineer in a studio doing a job and then slowly make a transition to production, which I'm mainly interested in? Most of the people told me like, if you want to stay in the production side, stay over there, don't come into sound engineering, because if you are into sound engineering, you'll either end up being there or being, you know, you'll be a nobody.
So when you're saying production, you're talking about music production,
music
that's
production,
what you really
yes,
want to
yeah,
do,
yeah,
is what you're
production,
saying.
Yes. So it, like what's your take on that?
They're both pros and cons to that, actually. I know some people who've actually were sound engineers and who actually worked with a music director as a sound engineer, you know, putting his sessions together, and then slowly the music director found out that they also do good music. And I mean, I'm talking some people working with A.R. Rahman as well, who actually came in as sound engineer. There's one girl there, Srinidhi. She actually came in as a sound engineer from SAE College. So worked with him as a sound engineer, and one day he was doing something and she was saying, no sir, that pitch was not okay. How do you know? Sir, I play music. Oh, you play music? Oh, what do you play? Show me what you do. So he started playing, oh, you're good. So go back, and like, he actually sent her back to KM College to do some more piano work and said, why don't you go and study some more? And now she actually assists him in music production as well. So there are cases where that does happen. But what people tell you that yes, to stick to one line and actually try and get into production is purely from the point of view of experience. If you start off in production, at least by the time you yourself become a music producer, you've gained enough experience in that production line. So yes, to start off there is definitely better. But if you don't want to digress and like, you know, like you do a, what should I call a, or a call operator job in the night and then do production or engineering in the morning, no. But at least here, if you do sound engineering, if you're not getting production, at least you're in the same part of the industry. If you can graduate to that, yes. Rather than leaving the industry and doing something else during the day or in the night. If you get an option, yes. But the sooner you graduate to within the production side and start going from there, nothing like it.
Some sound engineers do become music producers because of that involvement of seeing what, you know, they're working in that environment all the time. But I think it's definitely a different, very different job. It's a very different sort of scenario.
But also you have to be a musician. I mean, in a sense, you need to be somebody who understands music and knows music, obviously. It's difficult to be a sound engineer and not know music. You can survive. There are a lot of them who do that. Aisa nahi hai. But it definitely helps to know the music, because when you are punching in stuff, when you can hear something is out of tune, when you know something is not working, you know, you can immediately react to that. I mean, when I was doing my course in Toronto, I remember having to do grade 3 music theory was mandatory. It was a credit course. You can't run away from it. Because you're hearing a new piece of music coming in, you have no idea about what the music is. So when you see a score sheet in front of you, you exactly know what's going to happen. Who are going to dub? There are strings, there are cellos, there's double violin today, there's a conga, so you know immediately what's going to happen. And sometimes the music director will just tell you, bar 42 on the up, punch in. If you don't know what that is, and I'm talking about analog days, you are going to be out of a job very soon. So from that grounding and training, if you have and you come to the engineering side, it definitely is a big help to know what's going on. And I would say that you might not play an instrument, you might not be practicing musician, but to know about the basics of the rhythm structures, the meter, the basic cycle of fifths, just the basics of music as an engineer is a huge advantage. It's not that you have to learn and then come into engineering. You can still learn it side by side. It's not far removed from that. You can teach yourself that. I know so many people who are actually relatively pitch perfect, but they taught themselves that. They were not born with it. So you can learn it. It's an art. You just have to give time. You can definitely learn it. And it definitely helps. I find most clients of mine come to me also because they resonate with the kind of music I listen to as well. And I think that's very important as a sound engineer, that if you're freelancing, then most people will kind of, clients will come to you because of the kind of music that you like and do, and they like that sound. So if you have same references, life becomes easy. For what Rabbi Shergill to tell me, I'm looking for that sound with Bruce Springsteen having that song in Nebraska album. If I already heard it, I've grown with it, I know exactly what he wants. I don't have to kind of Google search it. So having the same references with a client who has, and he knows what kind of music you do, it definitely has. And you see all over the world, most people who producer, engineers, who have a particular style of or song genre that they work in, they've become good at that. And people want to gravitate to them to kind of get that kind of music. So finding, as composers, as arrangers, as producers, finding an engineer who resonates with your kind of music will definitely help you to achieve what you have in your head, because they, you know, you're communicating much faster with them when you're working, so you become more efficient when you're working.
I think that's very true. We've got some composers and obviously a lot of musicians here as well. When you're working in your own home scenario, your own home studio, then you kind of engineer yourself, you do your own thing. I think there's nothing like when you go to a studio and you've got a great engineer who does understand. Rashid, I'd love to just have a little chat. Would you join us? What made you say, I need to leave London and come here? Because I mean, I did a similar thing, although I'm not here so much, but I mean, you know, lived here quite a lot. So what was it for you? What did you?
I think what KJ said, he said something very interesting, that going back from London, traveling to projects in India, and then going back, you kind of lose the flow of it, you know? And I realized,
it's sort of stop-starts.
Sporadic.
Yeah.
It stop-starts, and I realized that I need to be here because a lot of things happen very spontaneously.
Definitely here.
And I was losing out on the fact that things happen very spontaneously, so I made the conscious decision to actually say, no, I've got to be in the circle. The moment you're out of the circle, it's kind of like a little bit of, you lose out on opportunities.
And was that a big commitment to you? Was it a big change?
Yeah, it was huge.
You know, it's great for you to come and talk about your experience, because there's nothing like having, you know, I was going to play music and get stuff played today, but you know, you don't want to hear music, you can go and listen to the music these guys have done. But when you've got them in front of you, giving you their life experiences, that is something precious.
I don't think anything can compare to that, because I was just another example quickly, at one of the AES convention in the US, and I happened to attend a session which had Phil Ramone, who's not anymore there, Mr. Bruce Sweden, Hugh Perrin, and one more person, I'm forgetting the name, and all four were there in the front of you, and their experience in about 1 hour, 45 minutes of, you know, condensed their entire experience into 1 hour, 45 minutes of a class of about 100 people who were attending, and it was packed, it was a small place. I always go back to that saying, how much you can learn, if you really want to learn, be a sponge, how much you can sponge off that just by sitting and hearing them talk is fascinating. Or as an engineer, musician, you go to another studio. I was with Stephen Fitzmaurice at the PS room doing Omkara mixes with him. And I just sat there. I didn't do anything. I just sat there and he just worked. And I just watched him work.
He's amazing. In fact, yeah. The recording session that I did, he mixed.
Yeah.
He mixed the Metropolis.
Metropolis.
Yeah, and he was...
So I just sat and watched him. He asked me, what do you do? And I said, this is what I did. Oh, great. Okay, so tell me about the music, if I'm doing everything okay. He wanted to know what a DAF is, because he'd never heard that before. And stuff like that. But just watching him work, I didn't ask him anything.
He mixed all the Seal stuff, didn't he?
Sorry?
He mixed all the Seal.
He's done the Seal albums with Trevor Horn. He's
worked
a lot with
him. Yes.
Great guy. Great, good set of ears, very good sensibility, knows how to use the gear and be sensitive to the music. I mean, the Omkara songs were mixed by him. Fabulous stuff he did. First time he was doing Indian music for film, and he just had a ball doing it. But just watching and seeing him work, you learn so much. You know, you are imbibing so much just doing that. So I think you just need to keep your ears and eyes open. Even when you're somewhere else, it might not be your session, or you know, you're just watching an engineer. What happens, I find, sometimes music composers take things for granted, like engineers working, say, okay, just set up this thing, and they leave.
Yeah.
I think just stay there. Just
watch
what they're
doing.
Absolutely,
watch how
they're
doing.
Watch what
they're
doing, and you will somehow get an idea how things work, and it'll help you next time when you visualize something, that this is in terms of time, in terms of placement, in terms of what sound you're going to get, because they did that. You will just start getting some ideas into your head on that.
I think the thing is that we never can stop learning. It doesn't matter what level you are in whatever you do, there's always more to learn. You know, already I've just, you know, been inspired by these guys and just, you know, hearing about, you know, their journeys. Muncie, great to have you here as well. And I think you are an inspiration to, you know, another generation. Rashid as well, just, I really appreciate you, you know, joining us. Any sort of words of, you know, final words that you'd like to say?
From one point you mentioned earlier, what I've tried to do, although I'm a singer and a musician, I've always also tried to take an interest in music technology and try to become savvy in the pre-production stage at least.
Yeah.
So you understand, you become multi-dimensional.
Yeah.
You understand the whole process of where the music idea starts to where it ends. But since I've come here, I've found lots of doors open, collaborations, lots of people willing to do stuff together, which is not something that you find in London as much, probably agree, don't you?
No, I think it's been very insightful. Thank you, Rashid, KJ, Muncie. Thank you so much.